So how does the Big Bang stack up as a scientific model? How does it fit those criteria? Is it relatively simple? And I would say, you know, it started out that way, but not anymore. The latest models of the Big Bang are very complicated. In fact, it's hard for me to keep them straight. And I've studied these things at the graduate level, but it's hard for me to keep them straight because there's a lot of arbitrary assumptions that have been tacked on to that to make it fit the observations, because the original model did not really fit the observations, as we'll come back to. Yeah. So is it simple? No. It's very complex. We'll talk about inflation and things like that, all these things that have been tacked on. Does it make correct specific predictions? No. And if you think about it, you haven't seen any. You've probably never seen in a newspaper, as predicted by the Big Bang, astronomers have now found this.
Right.
But all the time you'll see astronomers are having to rethink their ideas of cosmology as this new discovery is made. Isn't that true?
It is true.
And that doesn't happen in a lot of areas of science, but it does happen a lot in cosmology because the basic paradigm is wrong. And so I would say it doesn't really make specific predictions. The one I'll give you is the cosmic microwave background.
Right.
In 1964, Penzias and Wilson discovered that the entire universe is emitting microwaves. And that's been counted as a successful prediction of the Big Bang. And that's sort of true, but not completely, because the Big Bang did predict that the universe should have an average temperature and therefore will emit radiation. But any model of the universe says it ought to have an average temperature and therefore ought to emit radiation. They just didn't realize that at the time.
Okay.
The competing model, the steady state, didn't realize that it too would have to have microwaves.
Okay.
And so you see, my point is, it's not the Big Bang that predicts that specifically. Any model of the universe should expect to see microwaves out in space, because the universe, that just means the universe has an average temperature, and anything that has temperature in space will give off radiation, in this case microwaves.
Now, is it true that even the CMB, we have a horizon problem?
Yes.
Will we talk about that a little bit?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
So the Big Bang has a horizon problem, which they've come up with a rescuing device called inflation.
Yes.
And even this is just one more thing they have to tack on to try to salvage the theory.
It is. It's a rescuing device.
Okay.
Let's come back to that in
just
a minute.
Sure, sure.
Yeah. There are several scientific problems that I wanted to mention, and these are ones that would appear in honest secular textbooks. And that's why I like to use them, because they're ones that are in the literature.
Okay.
For example, the flatness problem, which has to deal with the fact that the expansion rate of the universe is very finely balanced with the gravity of the universe. Expansion tends to make the universe bigger, gravity tends to want to bring it back, okay?
Yeah.
And those two are almost exactly balanced. And if you run the equation backwards, that means that the Big Bang, they would have to be really, really accurately balanced. It'd be like if you had an egg standing on its end like that, just ready to fall over, you'd say, wow, it must have been really finely balanced at one point. So it's a problem, because why would it be that way if it was just an accident? Why would these two things be so exactly balanced?
Mm-hmm.
If the universe is thousands of years old, it's not as much of an issue, you see. And we would say, well, it is balanced anyway, because we have a creator, and we'd expect that. There's the horizon problem, what you just mentioned.
Yep.
And this is it's interesting, because this is a light travel time problem. And that's funny, because the Big Bangers say, well, you believe in a young universe? How do you get the light from those galaxies to Earth in thousands of years? They have the same type of issue.
Wow.
It's not with starlight, but it's the same type of issue. It has to do with this cosmic microwave background that we see. It turns out that the cosmic microwave background has about the same temperature no matter where you look. There's a characteristic temperature of that. And yet, according to the Big Bang, it should have started out with very different temperatures, different places. So let's say A is a hot spot and B is a cold spot.
Okay.
So you should have hot spots and cold spots, and they should be very, very different.
Yes.
But today, it's almost uniform. Now, how does that happen? Well, obviously, A had to dump its energy to B.
To
even out those temperatures. But the problem is, even if you give them their 14 billion years, there has not been enough time for light, the fastest substance, to travel from A to B even once to even out those temperatures.
Oh.
It's a light travel time problem.
Yes.
They need to get light to travel that distance in less time than is possible given their model. Isn't that interesting?
It is.
And it doesn't help to make the universe older, because then that just makes the spots farther apart, and
it
doesn't help.
Problem.
It doesn't help. So that's the horizon problem. It's a light travel time problem.
Hmm.
And then they tried the creationists for having a light travel time problem. And I think ours is solvable.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's the monopole problem. You probably played with magnets. Magnets have a north pole and a south pole. A monopole is a theoretical magnet that has only one pole, just a north or just a south.
Okay.
And as far as we know, they don't exist. They should be created. Physics that we understand suggests that they should have been created in the Big Bang, because the temperatures are very, very high, and that should produce these magnetic monopoles. And yet we've not found even one anywhere in the universe. So they call that the monopole problem. But it's not a problem if you believe, well, God just didn't bother to create those particles.
Exactly.
Apparently they're not necessary for our existence or anything like that. Now, these three problems, flatness, horizon, and monopole, secular astronomers have attempted to solve these with what they call inflation. You mentioned that earlier.
Okay.
So an inflation is attempt, and it tries to solve all those three, and it tries to do them simultaneously.
Uh-huh.
And basically it's the idea that the universe, when it was expanding, suddenly expanded at a much quicker rate and then dropped back down to the slow rate. It seems very arbitrary to me.
Is there any mechanism that would have caused this inflation?
Well, they claim there are certain mechanisms that can cause symmetry breaking and things like that. I'm not sure if there are logically sufficient mechanisms to do it, but it is something that I think is problem. And I think if there's really no supporting evidence for inflation. It seems to me it's just a rescuing device.
Yeah.
And for time's sake, let me hit just one more that would not be solved even if inflation were true, and that's the baryon number problem.
Okay.
This one's gold, and it's easy to understand.
Yeah.
Remember, in the Big Bang, energy is supposed to become matter.
Matter.
Okay? And we know that energy can turn into matter, but any time we do it, you get an equal amount of antimatter, where the charges of the particles are reversed. And so every time we take energy and make matter, we get an equal amount of antimatter. Matter, antimatter. And they're perfectly balanced.
Yeah.
But this universe is matter only, or almost all matter only.
Okay.
And so if the Big Bang were true, our universe should have an equal part of matter and antimatter, but instead it's almost all matter.
Matter.
That's called the baryon number problem, and it is a problem for the Big Bang model, but it's a feature for creation. God made our universe almost all matter only because when matter and antimatter touch, they destroy each other rather violently. And so it's a design feature that our universe is almost entirely made of matter.
Our Creator has planned for even that, the
That's right.
smallest of all details.
That's right.
Thank you, Dr. Lisle, for being here. This just gives us a lot of confidence in the Word of God, doesn't it?
Amen.
All right, we'll have to have you back on another program.
Sounds good. Thank you.